Another common example that leads to systems of differential equations is that of chemical reactions. In this case, we're going to let A and B be the concentrations of two chemicals, and we're going to assume that A transforms into B at a rate proportional to the amount of A, and B transforms into A at a rate proportional to the amount of B. This is called a first-order reversible reaction, and so we have A is going to transform into B at a rate proportional to A, we'll call the rate K1, and then B transforms back into A at a rate proportional to B, and we call that rate K2. So now we want to express that as a system of differential equations. So the rate of change of A is proportional to the amount of A. The amount that is lost when transforming into B is proportional to the amount A, so that's minus K1 times A. Of course, that transforms into B, so the rate of change of B is equal to K1 times A as well. So what's lost from A is gained in B. On the flip side, we have that B transforms into A at a rate proportional to B, so we gain K2 times B in the dA/dt equation, but then lose K2 times B in the dB/dt equation. And that gives us a system of differential equations that describes A and B during this reaction. Now, there's something interesting about this system of differential equations. We can actually look at dA/dt plus dB/dt. By the way, that's the same thing as the derivative of A plus B. And we notice that if we sum these two equations, they sum to zero. So the derivative of A plus B is equal to zero. That tells us that A plus B must be equal to a constant. If we give initial conditions, that constant would have to be A0 plus B0, how much we started with chemical A and how much we started with chemical B. And so this is actually an expression of conservation of mass, that matter is not created or destroyed. Now I'd like to look at the phase plane for this equation. And so we will open up again the phase plane's activity in slope fields. Okay, here I've let K1 be 2 and K2 be 1. And you can see that solutions, if I start, say, with nothing for B and then 10 of A, solutions seem to approach an equilibrium point there. But if I start with, say, 0 of A and 10 of B, then solutions also seem to approach an equilibrium point. Seems to be about at the same place. But then if I start in other positions, we approach different equilibrium points. And so there seems to be multiple equilibrium points here, not just one equilibrium point. And that actually we can see with the equation, because the second equation is just minus the first equation here. So if I go back and I look at this system, then I will notice that an equilibrium occurs when only one of these equations is equal to zero, because if one of the equations is equal to zero, then the other equation must be equal to zero. So we have an equilibrium when, let's say, B is equal to K1 over K2 times A, if along that line. So in fact, you can see the phase plane here. We have kind of a line of equilibrium points here. Each one of the points on this line is on the line B equals K1 over K2 times A. And each point there is an equilibrium point. And so Unlike the previous example, the equilibrium that this system approaches depends on the initial conditions. It depends on how much of chemical A and B we had to begin with. Okay, so the equilibrium for that system does occur where dA dt is equal to zero, but that's also where dB dt is equal to zero. Okay, in that case, B must be K1 over K2 times A. And so that system is interesting because it has infinitely many equilibrium points. So let's move on to a final example that should seem familiar, okay? And that is this second order linear differential equation, A times X double prime plus B times X prime plus C times X is equal to zero. And it turns out that we can turn this system, this second order differential equation, into a first order system of differential equations. Essentially, we can let V equal dx dt. We can think about x as being position and v as being the velocity. So dx dt we can say is equal to the velocity, which is v. Now, if dx dt is equal to v, then I can rewrite this equation as being plus b times v of t plus c times x of t. But x double prime of t is, in fact, v prime of t. And so I can think about this equation as being a v prime of t plus b v of t plus c x of t is equal to zero. And so I can solve for v prime, okay? A v prime of t is equal to negative b v of t. Actually, I'm going to put the other one first. Minus c x of t minus b v of t. And then finally, I can divide by a so that dv dt is equal to minus c over a x of t minus b over a v of t. Here I am assuming that a is not zero, but if A were zero, then we'd have a first order differential equation, not a second order differential equation. Okay, so now I have a system, and the system is describing both position and velocity. So I can rewrite this in matrix form as the derivative of X and V being 0, 1 times the vector X, V, and then minus c over a minus b over a times the vector x, v. And so now I can see that there's a relationship between second order equations and first order systems of equations. We will analyze this example more in a later video.